There was a time before The Verge, a time of infinite space, of infinite time. And then, in another moment, The Verge appeared, pulsating, growing, waiting for you, like a chud in a sewer, waiting to attack you, waiting to assault your senses with sound and light and vision, waiting to make you physically uncomfortable, and yet physically comfortable. That's why The Verge is an enigma, a paradox, a riddle which solves itself. Of course, on The Verge, things aren't always as they seem. Do you like senators? Do you like journalists? Do you like musicians? Do you like the Samsung Series 9 laptop? If you said yes to any of those questions, you might like our show, or you might not. That's excellent. That's the good stuff. Hi. Hi, and welcome to On The Verge. You guys know Paul Miller and Nilay Patel. Here they are. You feel free to give them a round of applause.
Thank you.
They call that a cold open in the industry.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. We have a great show. First off, thank you guys for coming. We have an awesome show. Mary Jo Foley is here. We have Nilay went to D.C. and talked to Senator Al Franken, which is a very interesting interview. We have giveaways. We're giving away the Samsung Series 9 laptop, three of them. And we have a musical guest, Chipocrite. Yeah. And it's going to be good. We have a big show.
A lot of
stuff planned.
Yeah. Some enigmas.
Are going to happen. We got some surprises. But first, we're going to talk about news. Mountain Lion just came out for Apple computers. People still call them computers? I got to laugh on that. What is a computer? I know we're living in the post-PC era, but they're still updating software for PCs. Mountain Lion, Nilay, you reviewed it.
I did.
What do you think?
I really hated Lion, so I was kind of expecting to really dislike Mountain Lion.
Yeah.
But I really like it. It's kind of great.
I love Lion, and I played around with someone with Mountain Lion and the early versions they had, like messages and notifications, and it seemed they just weren't that well executed. Did they fix that?
They didn't fix that stuff.
So why do you like?
All of the rest of it's great.
And then, but the new features is great.
Well, messages is just broken, and it won't be fixed until you can. It wants you to always use iMessage for everything,
right?
And that won't work until you can iMessage a phone with a phone number from your thing, and that's coming with iOS 6. So that'll be fixed later.
I'll tell you, you're talking about little meaningless stuff here. I'll tell you what the big problem is with Mountain Lion is it has Facebook integration.
Well, it's coming.
By the way, has anybody
in the fall? It's coming.
Well, the Facebook integration is coming, so nobody here knows. Then I was going to ask, but Facebook integration is it dumps all of your Facebook contacts into your address book, and puts all of their birthdays into your calendar. Those are your options. You can either do it or not do it. You can't like filter. So by the way, I'm not boasting, but I have 2,900 friends on Facebook.
Friends
of mine who I hang out with all the time, who I love and who love me, when you have a lot of really good close friends and all of their birthdays appear in your calendar, it's a little troubling.
Well, the thing is, I just had a birthday and you didn't say anything. Definitely in your calendar.
But I did send you an e-card with a Groupon gift in it. Which it has now expired. Thanks. Also, the e-card has expired.
Well,
and also, it's the kind of e-card where it will delete itself from your inbox.
Right.
So when you check it, if you don't see it, it shouldn't come as a surprise because it was self-deleted by the e-card itself. But I did try to wish you a happy birthday.
Well, your slice of ice cream cake melted.
So. Did you have ice cream cake?
No, I did.
How was it?
It was great.
And that's our show. Thanks, everyone. All right, there's other news. We should move on to it. Today was actually big news today. Crazy news. Google, what? Why are you looking at me like that? You don't think there was crazy news today? Google Fiber.
It's sort of.
Have you guys heard about this?
Yeah.
Google, God, it's so nerdy. Google Fiber, they're starting their own fiber service in Kansas City, Kansas, and Missouri. Missouri, not a word. Mm. Yeah. Not a name of a place.
They had both mayors on the stage.
They had both mayors, 1,000 Mbips up and down. 1,000. I have 50 down on Time Warner Cable.
I can't even imagine.
And that's high.
Yeah, you pay like a lot of money for that.
I pay $100 a month for it.
Yeah.
And five up.
This is $70 a month.
This is $1,000. It's actually 120. Sorry, it's 120 bucks. They have TV service, 120 bucks.
If you just want the internet.
With 1,000 up and down, and then with just the internet, it is
$70.
$70 a month.
We're insane.
1,000 up and down.
I just, what is, I mean, 1,000 is great, but what is googly about this?
Like, it's open. Like, it's for everybody.
No, it sounds like Comcast.
It sounds like a really good Comcast.
It's audacious. It's what rich people do because they have too much time.
It's an audacious move.
They're like, oh my God, so much money.
But like, but they're also doing
Are there TV shows like recorded into your Google?
Yes. No, hold on. Wait a second. So they have TV
and then like the little.
Well, they don't have. There's not a lot of Google integration.
Right.
But they have. There are some really googly things about it.
Okay.
Like they're giving you a box with 2 terabytes of storage,
right?
And you can record
8 shows at once.
You can record 8 things at once
into
on the TV
cloud?
Service to the box.
To the box.
But how are you? It's local. What are you gonna?
Yeah, I mean, I know everything in the Google is everything else.
Everything
you know,
in
for
Google,
a guy, I have to say, for a guy, Google. For a guy who has no internet.
Yeah.
you are yeah. awfully picky about what Google is doing with the internet. Maybe you ought to just shut up.
Yeah.
About the internet.
Well, you know what? There is like a.
That's really mean. I feel
bad. No, but this is like classic. Like, it's almost like something Microsoft would do. Like, they launch this product that isn't integrated with any of their other products. So, like, you have a cable box in your house that isn't a Google TV. They're going to give you a Nexus 7 tablet that's running an app that's, like, totally apart from the Google Play Store. I mean, it's just.
Yeah, the Nexus 7 is the remote. It's bundled.
Yeah, but it's
running. Can I just talk about the bundle for a second? I just want to go back to this.
Go to the bundle.
So they're actually, like, doing this thing where you have to have a rally and you get everybody in your area to say you want this service. It's like they can't build it until enough people say they want it. And it costs $300 to install in your house.
Mm-hmm.
But they waive that, right, if you get it for 2 years?
I think so.
You think I'd know more about this since we write about technology for a living.
Yeah.
But so you get TV service with hundreds of channels, no HBO, no ESPN, and no CNN, though, which is a little bit
shocking. Yet. Maybe they'll get it.
Not yet. Somebody was exclaimed, what the F up there.
Yeah.
They're very angry.
I heard that.
Like, how dare you? It's in Kansas, so what does it matter?
That guy's just like, cannot get it.
You're like, I won't pay for this because I can't possibly pay for it because I live in New York. But so it's like they give you a TV box, a storage box, a network box, I'm not making this up, 3 different boxes, and then the remote, which they bundle, is the Nexus 7 tablet.
Yeah, but then there's also a little...
There's a little Bluetooth remote, yeah. I just think it's crazy. It's crazy.
No, it's like a very audacious, but like, what's the
plan? If they did it here...
Is the plan for like Comcast executives to like sit in a boardroom and be like, guys,
if they did it here, it would be game over.
But they can't, right? I mean, there's like a huge monopoly.
That's right. That's
because there's a monopoly. In New York.
Anyhow, so Dieter Bone was there, one of our editors, the Bone Zone, as I like to refer to him, in an unfunny manner, which nobody ever laughs at. And you know, I feel like if I just keep saying it, it'll get funny, but it really doesn't. Dieter Bone was in Kansas City today, and he filed a little report. So take a look.
Hi, this is Dieter Bone for The Verge, and we are here in Kansas City for the Google Fiber launch at the beautiful Google Fiber Experience. And the service is going to come in several different tiers, most of which are going to be a full gigabit broadband, which is 1,000 megabits up and down. Google is going to decide where they build out the fiber based on a thing called, they're calling a rally, so different neighborhoods need to pick. But if you choose to pay the $300 and your neighborhood gets to be wired up, then you have a couple of options. Your first option is $120 for Google Fiber plus TV. And the only problem with that is it looks like there's some limitations on the TV channels. We're not seeing CNN, HBO, or even ESPN in their current lineup. If you pay $70 a month, you can get just the gigabit broadband, which is still pretty good. And then if your neighborhood is getting fiber, but you don't want to pay $70 a month, you can actually get standard regular broadband, 5 megabits down, for free for 7 years if you pay for the construction cost for them to wire your house up. The hardware that powers all this is pretty interesting. There is, of course, you know, a router that will have some Ethernet ports and provide Wi-Fi. On top of that, there is a storage box with 2 terabytes of storage that is used to store all your DVR material for all of your TVs. And then every single TV needs to have a relatively small box in order to be wired up and access Google TV. In addition, that TV box is also a Wi-Fi router, so it can extend your Wi-Fi network. The remote for Google TV is a Nexus 7. If you sign up for the TV package, you will get a free Nexus 7 tablet. There will also be a small Bluetooth remote if you prefer to use it that way. The rollout should happen sometime soon. They are having people register right now by September 9th in order to sign up. After that, we will see gigabit broadband in Kansas City. As for when it'll hit the rest of the country, Google's not saying yet.
So I'm excited.
Yeah.
I don't care what you say.
I'm moving to Kansas.
I don't care what Paul says.
Can I get I was born in Missouri. I can move back.
How do you go from A to B?
Maybe you should.
Yeah. Get out. The theme of the show is that we kick Paul off the show.
Moving on.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys know this, but the first season of Star Trek The Next Generation is available on Blu-ray now. Do you know this? Very exciting. You probably read about it on your favorite Star Trek fan fiction site.
But it's not fictional.
This is fan fact.
It's fan fact.
This is real.
Yeah.
This is happening. Anyhow, we got it. Jordan, one of our video guys, got it day one, like in the morning. And we've been watching it, and it looks great. It looks amazing. It's not widescreen. What is the reason? I don't know.
They didn't shoot it on a widescreen.
They didn't shoot it widescreen. And because they want to hurt my feelings.
Yeah.
So it's got the black bars on the side, but the picture quality looks really amazing. And I have to say, like, we were watching it, and it really, it's almost like watching it for the first time. You start to notice details that you never really picked up on before. In fact, we have a clip of it. Check this out.
Now entering quadrant 907, mark 3.
Shields and deflectors up, go to yellow alert.
I have located a vessel, sir. It is drifting.
Put it on main viewer.
Aye, sir.
Magnify. In engineering.
You really, there's a level of detail to that show, just an artistry to it.
Yeah, it's really progressive.
It's a very progressive style of editing.
Television is much more thoughtful.
Yeah. It just, HD brings it out.
Yeah.
Okay, so that is not an actual exact clip
That was a funny joke.
Oh, I gotta tell you, that wasn't really an exact scene from Star Trek The Next Generation. But they did actually have to re-edit all of these episodes because they were edited to tape. So they had to do the edits again.
Yeah, most of the effects were done in like standard definition. So they had to redo the...
I mean, you can see here an example of one of the effects.
it really does look amazing.
You can tell they've really... they're digital effects, clearly now, as opposed to models.
Digital.
Digital.
The part of the future.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. So, finally, our final piece of news. I don't know if you guys know, but Marissa Meyer. How's her name?
The internet.
Let's just say it's Meyer for the sake of the argument. She left Google, has become CEO of Yahoo, and is also pregnant, which everybody loves to talk about. Not me, of course.
No.
I don't care about it at all. It's not a big deal.
No.
I'm not upset. And she also has blonde hair. Not a big deal. She's a woman too. Anyhow, she's the CEO of Yahoo, and we've been talking about Yahoo a lot.
It's kind of a shocking amount.
Yeah, we've done some really good in-depth posts on it, and we were talking about like the things that Yahoo still has that are really valuable.
Not search.
Search is not one of them.
No.
You don't go to Yahoo to find something.
No.
I mean, you might, but you should.
Maybe to find another search engine.
To find it. I don't even know how that would work. But I think Yahoo Answers is actually a really valuable piece of Yahoo that has not been fully exploited. And we were thinking, how do you maximize the value of it? And the obvious answer was you turn it into some kind of trivia game show.
It's a trivia gold mine.
A trivia gold mine, really. And, you know, it's a game show that you might play like Jeopardy. You know, you do the Yahoo Jeopardy or something. We were thinking maybe we'll try it out. And then we thought, or should we call it Yahoo Jeopardy? We didn't know if legally that would be a problem. So we went to some experts to see if we should call it Yahoo Jeopardy. Here, is it okay to use the name Jeopardy for your own game show? We got some varied responses. We weren't really sure what to do. For instance, Lil Stunna said, Lil Stunna said no. Yeah. So that obviously put us on guard. And then I believe, is it Angus? It said YOLO,
yeah.
Which to me was like, that was like, go for it.
Yeah.
Because you do only live once.
You show up in a trademark lawsuit, you go YOLO, the judge is like, cool.
But then finally, I think we got the real answer from an anonymous source, which is, I don't know why you'd want to do that. The name is already famous for another show. People who see the title on their schedule will be disappointed when it is something else.
Yeah.
When they see it on their program guide
yeah, TV guide.
On DirecTV.
That grandma game.
Where we will be airing Yahoo Jeopardy. Anyhow, so we decided we had to rename it, and we renamed it Jeopardy. And I think we should just play around right now. What do you say? Good. What do you think? Yeah?
This is Jeopardy.
We've got our three contestants here, hand chosen by yours truly. We've got Andrew Cybulska, is that right?
Yeah.
You're from Staten Island.
Born and raised.
And it says here you're addicted to gumballs. Is that right?
I got some in my pocket right now.
Interesting. Next up is Hannah Alexander from Brooklyn. It says you're physically incapable of driving 55.
Exactly.
Is that true?
Yeah,
really? I thought you, the Sammy Hagar reference? No, that's, all right, fine. And finally, Ryan Vinicombi, is that right?
Vinicombe.
I'm gonna call you Vinicombi, is that all right?
That's good.
From Pomfret, Connecticut, and we kissed.
That we did.
That is correct. Andrew, I believe during a serious game of D&D backstage, you took control of the board to start with.
Yeah.
Choose your category and your dollar amount and we'll get going.
Well, I don't see bubblegum on there, so I guess I'll just go for food for 500, please.
Food for 500, and the answer is, it would just rot away. Is your air horn broken?
I think so.
I saw smoke come out of it, all right.
Not good.
Ryan, what is your answer for it would just rot away? And remember, it has to be posed as a question.
What is pumpkins in November?
That's close. That is really close. But the actual question was, what would happen if you planted an entire strawberry?
Not quite.
Hannah, you've got control of the board.
Hey.
You've got control of the board. Where do you want to take us next?
Pop culture for 500.
Pop culture for 500. And the answer is... shift key? Ah, yes. Andrew.
How do you yell very loudly?
That is interesting. How do you make one word on MySpace all caps was the correct question. Ryan, you have control of the board now.
All right, I'll take potent potables for 500.
Great choice. Potent potables for 500. And the answer is, go for it. You'll never know unless you try. A life with no regrets is a life unlived. Yes. Yes. Yes, Ryan.
YOLO?
That's very close. But I'm afraid the correct question was, could I get drunk if I bought a pack of alcohol swabs and sucked them? Andrew, back to you for control. Where do you want to go?
Let me go the human body for 200.
The human body for 200, and the answer is, it's all completely random. Andrew.
What is sex like? Huh.
Well, I mean, it's a little related, but I'm afraid that's wrong. The question was, what causes the difference between an innie or outie belly button? Moving on, Hannah, you've got the board.
The human body for 500.
Oh, really? The human body for 500. And the answer is no. Have you ever cried snot?
Wasn't that the answer?
That's the answer. And you need to tell me what the question is. You know, like a normal game of Jeopardy. Really, no one's gonna buzz in.
No.
Ryan.
What is having swine flu like?
I'm afraid the question was actually, if you drink milk through your nose, will it come out of your eye and how? Yes, you were so close. Oh, it looks like we're out of time. We've got to go right into final Jeopardy. So here is the final Jeopardy answer. The song, little known fact, is about Dumbledore from Harry Potter. If you look at the lyrics further, there are more context clues that the song is about the headmaster of Hogwarts. Pens down, pens down. I'm afraid time is up. I'm gonna have to see your answers now, starting with Andrew. Can we see what you put down?
What is Nine Inch Nails' song Closer about?
Well, that is actually shockingly close. But I'm afraid you're incorrect. Hannah?
Oh, what is dum di dum dum dum?
That is also incorrect. Ryan?
What is Call Me Maybe about? Help.
Wow. Very close, but wrong, ultimately. I'm afraid that the question was, why does Kesha say, I like your beard, and your love is my drug? And that's Jeopardy for the night. Give these guys a round of applause. Now, I know that none of them got a single thing right, but they're not leaving empty-handed. They're all going to go home with these professional signed Jeopardy shirts, which certainly were not ironed on a few hours ago and will be fine in the wash. So you guys all get one of these, and thank you so much for playing. Let's have another round of applause for our contestants. Good sports. And now something very special. Nilay went down to D.C. to talk to Senator Al Franken, and we have video to prove it. Take a look at this, and we will be right back.
We're here. We're in Washington, D.C., the Capitol building, a building full of hundreds of people who have literally no idea how the internet works. But there are a couple of people who get it. Senator Al Franken is one of them. He let us into his office to hang out and talk about the future of the internet. So, Senator Franken, thank you for joining us today. It's kind of an
honor
to be here.
You're very welcome. Pleasure to be on your, what do you call this? It's not airwaves.
Not airwaves. Our pipes, our tubes.
Your tubes.
Our tubes. Is that? That's probably
well, that's what the internet is. It's a
series of tubes.
Series of tubes, yeah.
You have an interesting story, first of all. I think that people kind of... They know an old Al Franken,
yeah.
And now there's a modern, reborn Al Franken, a beautiful political butterfly. How do you go from one to the other?
Oh, it's really odd. It made perfect sense to me.
Yeah.
A lot of the comedy I did starting in high school was satire, political satire, and on SNL wrote a lot of the political. I did a lot of stupid, silly comedy stuff. But always was very, very interested in politics.
So one thing I think is really interesting about your political trajectory over the past few years is that you've been very focused on technology.
Right.
You're obviously very focused on privacy. You lead this subcommittee on privacy and technology and the law. Why have you chosen to kind of like lead in that area as opposed to all the myriad other things that you can choose in the Senate?
Well, it's just an interesting area. I mean, we have, I'm on the Judiciary Committee, which I didn't ask for. I mean, I thought, you know, 90 of these people are lawyers. Why should I be on the committee?
It's probably for the best, actually.
Yeah, it actually was for the best. And I've actually been interested in constitutional issues for a long time. But I also came from out of the communications industry, you know, telecommunications industry. So what was kind of interesting is when Comcast NBC came up, I sort of felt like the one who understood it the most on the antitrust subcommittee. So I felt like this was an area that I kind of understood better than than most of my colleagues on judiciary. So I thought I'd jump in, and we kind of invented it. Yeah. I mean, we, you know, the subcommittee on privacy, technology, and the law, and also just constitutionally, Goodwin Liu, who was turned down, he was this brilliant law professor who was turned down because he was so brilliant and Asian American.
Yeah.
And they didn't want him, and
so
he's young.
They didn't confirm him.
Well, the Republicans didn't want him confirmed because he was so brilliant and young that they knew, well, okay, he'll be on the Supreme Court someday if we don't stop him now.
Yeah.
And so they did. And but he was, you know, criticized by the Republicans for believing in a living constitution. Mm-hmm. And they and he kind of said, well, a living constitution, of course the constitution's living because not everything that existed existed then.
Right.
For example, and then he used the telephone. The founding fathers did not anticipate the telephone. And at a certain point, the Supreme Court had to decide what were people's expectations of privacy with the, is wiretapping a telephone a violation of the Fourth Amendment? Mm-hmm. And they decided it was. So you need a warrant to tap someone's phone. And in the same way, just every technology has to be sort of seen through that lens.
Right. Well, so the lens of both, it enables all this, intercommunication, enables new innovation, but then it also enables the government to spy on you, or the lens of there's...
Well, it's not the government spying on you necessarily. Very often now, this is actually... It's corporations are able to get all this information. Mm-hmm. So it's actually a little different than what most people thought of privacy law.
Right.
Because most people always thought of privacy law as the government, you know, finding out what you're reading, or the government finding out...
Big brother.
Big brother.
Yeah.
This is now corporate big brother. And people don't... I think people have a fundamental right to privacy, and they have a fundamental right to know what at least what's being taken... Mm-hmm. And being stored and control over it, whether it goes to third parties, and they don't.
So you've proposed, you mean you've held a few hearings on it. You did the location tracking one a few months ago. There's a hearing on that. You just held a hearing on facial recognition technology and how they're being used. And what I thought was interesting about that is you had Facebook's head of privacy in there, and then you had the FBI in there.
Right.
Do their interests align? Can you regulate both of them with the same kind of law, or do you have to split them apart?
Boy, that's a really good question. I think we're gonna have to split them apart. And I think it might be easier to regulate the FBI. it's just that, Facebook literally has, I guess, what, 900 million?
Yeah, they're popular.
It's popular. And that means, in this regard, they have these face prints. Mm-hmm. Of maybe one out of every, seven people on Earth or something. You know, I think people are more comfortable making rules to contain government than they are to, private enterprise or corporations or private entities.
So I think that actually leads me into a whole set of issues around net neutrality, right? Because you were a very firm supporter of net neutrality.
I have always been, yeah.
Yeah, at that moment, you were a particularly vocal supporter.
Yes.
When the FCC was debating it, now it's...
Well, when the FCC was debating it, and then when the House tried to overturn it.
Yeah.
And so...
I was very disappointed that day. Our readers know that I do a lot of swearing when we talk about net neutrality, because I passionately believe it's important.
Well, according to a lot of House members, the internet did just fine.
Yeah.
Without net neutrality.
Yeah. Well,
which is just hilarious. That's my favorite thing. House members would get on the floor and go, like, you've seen all this expansion of the internet without net neutrality. Why have it now?
Yeah. What's your answer?
I would calmly say, that's, we don't want to change anything.
Yeah.
That's the architecture. Net neutrality is the architecture of the internet and has been the architecture of the internet. And we want to preserve that. Mm-hmm. That's my answer.
So
that would be my calm answer.
Calm answer. Well, I mostly do a lot of like fist pounding. So, I mean, have you heard, for example, there's rumors that, you know, the iPhone has FaceTime video calling and they're going to enable it over the carriers, right? Mm-hmm. They're going to enable it so you can do it over AT&T and Verizon's like mobile networks. And there's rumors that AT&T is going to like charge you for it,
right,
as an additional feature, but it's just the same data.
Yes, that's wrong.
So that's in your opinion just completely wrong.
Yeah.
Is there any room? I mean, I agree with you. I'm asking, is there any room?
I think that you have a thing called network management, we call it. You have a right to do that, and if you're overloading and crashing because people are using something that is making that happen, you have a right to say you can't do that, or we're going to have to charge you for that to incentivize not using it, or to decentivize.
Right. But so
disincentive.
We're going to punish you. AT&T should slap you on the wrist and say,
well, for doing something that would make our network crash if everybody did it.
Okay.
I could see that. That's network management. That I can understand that. Mm-hmm. But that's not what this is.
This is like tiers of service.
Yes, though. And that's wrong.
So,
because that's not the architecture we've had, and to me, that protects innovation. Mm-hmm. That freedom has been what has created the innovation over. Right. That's net neutrality.
You and I are having even at this level, which is like pretty high level. Let's talk about the basic concepts. A pretty nerdy conversation, right? About net neutrality and the architecture of the internet.
Not as nerdy as I imagine most of your
the time. I will nerd you out. I mean,
freak you out. It doesn't take much to nerd me out.
So I think that's really important.
Don't be too impressed with my chairmanship. Yeah, I'm
You're
convinced that you can nerd me.
I mean, isn't that the problem? I mean, we're trying to explain this concept that my readers kind of instinctively get. That you've, even at the level we're talking about it, you seem to understand, you're staunchly supportive of.
Yes.
But one level out of it, you've got an entire Congress full of people who don't seem to understand what's going on.
Yes.
And they don't have any technical expertise.
I mean, you have to sort through everything that's going on in Congress. Sometimes people... people who do understand things but pretend not to. Mm-hmm. There are people.
That was a very knowing.
There is self-delusion. There is not wanting to know. I mean, there's all kinds of levels here, and there's voting with your leadership.
Yeah.
Et cetera, and there are corporate interests, and that tend to, I don't know if you've heard of this thing called Citizens United.
Yeah.
Anyway,
So you don't think a corporation is a person?
I don't.
Shocking information.
I don't. And I, you know, corporations can live a lot longer.
Yeah.
Or shorter, I suppose. But no, they're not close. People.
So if you
you can't break a corporation's heart.
It's really disappointing, actually. I try every day. I should read some of my editorials about AT&T. So we've been talking about this balance between the public interest, the private interest. You've been talking about corporate interests. One of the things that our readers always talk about when they talk about corporate interest, of course.
Don't worry about it.
Oh, it's coming right through our mics.
Yeah, that's okay, people. That's one of parts of the sound. It's real. It's real. You'd pay for that. You'd have that sound effect to make it seem like you're at the Senate. Right. Okay.
So one of the things our readers always talk about when they worry about corporate interest and with the internet is SOPA and PIPA.
Sure.
You are a co-sponsor of PIPA.
Protect IP, sure.
What the hell happened there, man?
Well, no bigger champion than an open internet. I also care about intellectual property rights.
Yeah.
So,
Did the corporate interests win? Is that what happened there?
No, actually.
Because the internet guys were screaming from get-go, right? Don't do this. And it went through the Senate, and it was only in the House that, like, there was real traction when Google and Wikipedia blacked out. So what happened?
Well, no, it didn't get taken. It got traction. Believe me, what Pippa and Wikipedia did traction in the Senate too, and we heard those concerns, and very legitimate concerns. My concerns were both the openness of the internet, and they're also about, you know, I had someone in my office from a shoe company in Minnesota. It's a very well-known shoe company, and they get ripped off all the time. We're trying to target was overseas, you know, other country, rogue websites that pirate intellectual property. Again, the concerns of folks that are, I'm sure, watching today were heard loud and clear. Yeah. You know, and people are pirating fake pharmaceuticals that are dangerous. They're pirating a lot of stuff that people's jobs depend on, and so that it's trying to find the right spot there. But for now, I don't see us revisiting that anytime soon.
You think it's dead?
It's certainly dead for now, and I don't. You know, we would have to figure out how to, because I think probably most of your viewers believe that people have a right to their intellectual property. In other words, have a right to, our founders were, many of them were authors and inventors. And so they believed in, we wouldn't have a 747 these days if we wouldn't have a lot of this stuff if you couldn't patent things, for example. So that has to be, you have to find a way to protect that and at the same time protect everyone's rights.
So what I'm hearing,
have an open internet.
So what I'm hearing is like there's a balance, right, between, in that case, a balance between kind of media rights, intellectual property rights, and like what's happening on the internet now, the rights of almost consumers to do stuff with media as they wish. But how do you balance at a legislative level a place that has historically been pretty unregulated in terms of behavior and also enables so many new kinds of behavior that you might block with additional regulation? How do you balance sort of making sure?
Well, it depends. I guess it was how narrowly what behavior we're talking about. And if the behavior is what we were trying to achieve, and it was trying to stop foreign websites from pirating, clothes and pharmaceuticals and software and movies and all those kind of things. So that's the kind of behavior, which is an illegal behavior, and in this country is illegal, and this was an attempt to get at the foreign.
But can you do that with a technical solution of like let's monkey with DNS, or can you do that with another way? Because a technical solution is what bothered people, right?
Yeah, but the problem is that you had no legal solution because they're foreign entities, and we don't know where they are.
I think a technical solution is probably
trying. I got to. I actually do have to.
Senator Franken, it's really nice. Thanks for talking to us today.
Very well done. Very nicely done. We wanted to show you the whole thing because it is really a great conversation It's interesting you pressed him on SOPA, but he sent you back with a gift.
Well, so what's really crazy, that buzzer that went off is he literally was running. He was late to preside over the Senate. Like his staffers were like, "Come on, you got to bang the gavel and put the Senate."
He seemed unhurried the first time when it went off.
Yeah, but because he doesn't like to do it because they make the freshman senators like do it. It's like a punishment.
This is why our government isn't working. So, they don't respond to the buzzers,
which is an insane wave. Yeah. Anyway, so he gave us gifts. The day before, he held a hearing on all this Facebook privacy stuff, and he had this insane prop, which is right here.
A picture of it.
We can bring it out. Which is,
by the way, I saw this on the internet, and I was like, "Why is there that dialogue box over top of this photo?" I didn't notice the person's hand there.
He didn't think the other members of the Senate would know what a Facebook dialogue box looked like.
I like he had an assistant. This does not look real.
He had to print one out to show the Senate what Facebook looked like.
Yeah.
Which is crazy.
And then he gave it to us because he wasn't sure if some of our viewers knew what a Facebook.
Yeah.
Have you guys seen this? We all cracked up. So we asked for it, and he signed it for us.
It says
to Nilay and my friends at The Verge, learn more. which I don't know is like a positive what? Exhortation.
What?
Or, a bit of a bird.
Or if a senator just called me stupid.
You know what? Learn more, Nilay.
Well, Nilay, you did really good on that.
Anyhow, but we gotta move on. But this is very cool, and we're gonna put this in our bat cave with our giant penny, and that's gonna go in there. Okay. We're going to move on. I'm very excited about our next guest. She's been covering technology for 25 years, 10 years on Microsoft. She's the author of Microsoft 2.0, How Microsoft Plans to Stay Relevant in the Post-Gates Era. And she writes for CNET, ZDNet, has written for eWeek, Baseline. Let's just get her out here. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mary Jo Foley. Careful. Thank you for coming. Thank you so much. Doing. Be careful with the sofa. Oh boy.
Uh-oh.
Nilay during the interview, Nilay pushed the sofa off.
I'm extremely
of the back
drunk.
Of this. It's fine. Just don't make any sudden movements.
I won't.
Mary Jo, thank you for being here. Really, really appreciate it. So we wanted to have you on because we want to talk about Microsoft. I don't know if you've heard, you've been in the news a lot lately. What was that? Is everything okay? Are you all right, sir? Okay, good. Microsoft has been in the news a lot lately. You've been covering Microsoft. You cover Microsoft. You get some fantastic scoops. They don't. When I see them, I don't get angry or sad. I just think, what a great scoop. I wish I had that scoop. Anyhow, but you do. You've been covering Microsoft for a long time, and you really know them, and all the people there.
Yes.
They've just announced some pretty major stuff. I mean, Windows 8 we knew was coming.
Right.
We knew there was going to be another version of Windows Phone.
Mm-hmm.
The Surface. Is not something that was necessarily like a slam dunk. Like, right. Oh yeah, of course they're going to do this.
Yep.
What is your take on that? I mean, what do you think? Is this the right strategy for Microsoft in 2012 to make their own tablet, their own PC, essentially? What do you think?
All I can tell you is until I saw that Surface, I kind of thought Windows 8 was going to be a disaster.
Really?
But once I saw it, I was like, okay, now there's hope. There's a hardware form factor that has got me really excited.
So up until the Surface, I just want to be clear.
Yes.
You were like, Windows 8, total mistake.
You didn't
total.
See any partner hardware? No Asus, no HP?
It all kind of felt the same mm-hmm. to me. And I really wanted something really exciting. Because I have an iPad. I shouldn't say
Wait,
that.
What? No, I know. You actually wrote. You
it's like Ballmer going to arrest
actually,
you.
Actually, if I can digress for one quick second, you wrote a post years ago when you got your iPad.
I did.
And it was like, I got an iPad. And we had this big debate when we were at Engadget. We were like, should we cover this? I was like, well, Mary Jo buying an iPad doesn't seem like news. We had this big debate, and we actually ended up creating, was it Engadget Alt?
Yeah.
We ended up creating Engadget Alt because we were like, we want to be able to hit the stuff that is like interesting to us, but not news necessarily.
Right.
So anyhow, we actually brought a lot of that thinking to The Verge. So
nice.
You basically are the reason we exist when you think about your purchase of an iPad. But you bought an iPad.
I bought an iPad. In fact, there was a headline somewhere that said, Blood rains down on the Holy Land the day I bought my iPad.
Who wears that?
I think it was TechCrunch. TechCrunch.
I just feel like those kinds of really explosive headlines.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But I the reason I bought an iPad was because I couldn't find a Windows tablet that I loved.
Because they're all terrible.
They were all terrible.
Just terrible. Let's just be honest.
Horrible.
I mean, if Bill Gates, if that was the Gates vision,
yeah.
He needs glasses.
Right. Agreed.
Well, he wears glasses. He needs stronger glasses. He needs X-ray vision. I don't know what he needs, but anyhow, go on.
Yeah, but when I saw the Surface, and I haven't even gotten to see one in person yet. Like, I've just seen pictures.
I've seen one in person.
You have.
I've seen it, and I was allowed to touch it briefly. For a moment, you couldn't really use it. It's a nice piece of hardware.
Yeah.
It is really nice. And I will say that I felt, maybe this is how you felt, but they'd been telling this story, and I spoke to people, you know, Microsoft reps. I'm sure you talk to the same people, and they're like, you'll see, we've got a plan. And I was like, I don't get it. Like, this thing's not good to use on a laptop, and your tablet offerings are garbage at the moment. You know, nobody's really making a great Windows. Like, it's not just that the software doesn't really work that well, but it's like the hardware just isn't that
right.
good. So it was like, how is this going to work? What is this transitional device where I'm going back and forth? And when I saw the Surface and I saw the what do they call them?
Smart covers.
No, smart cover is...
Wrong vendor.
Smart cover is Apple.
Touch cover.
They're type cover and touch cover.
Right, yeah. Type
I
and
was
touch.
Like, oh,
smart.
I could touch. See how this would work. I could really see this working. But why Microsoft? Why aren't they partnering? Why didn't they go to partners and say, we want five of you guys to make these things?
I know. I wonder if they did.
You think they couldn't get them to make them?
You know,
you can get Asus and Samsung to do almost anything.
I mean, they'll do anything.
Yeah.
At all. It doesn't have to be making stuff either. You like take them out, you know. Anyhow, I'm sorry. I don't know where I'm going with this. But yeah, why Microsoft?
I'm not totally sure why they decided to take the plunge, because, you know, it's not a really popular move with their partners, as you might imagine. But
yeah. They've been very quiet about it, though.
At least on the record, they've been quiet.
Well,
about
didn't
it.
Who said it was like Asus or Acer or something? I always get them confused.
It was Acer, right? Wasn't it?
They poo-pooed the idea.
He's like, oh, it's just a gimmick. Don't worry. This is just a fake thing. They're not going to go through.
Well,
with
they
it.
Don't have a choice. I mean, what are you going to do if you're Dell, right?
Right.
You're going to leave Windows?
Well, Dell's basically, but they said they're not really doing consumer stuff.
Right, but any of you, if you make laptops and you're not Apple, what are you going to sell if you go away from Windows? And that's kind of like, Microsoft just
Android
woke up.
Android tablets and phones?
Linux? Linux desktop?
Yeah, Linux desktop. That's real. Mary Jo, that's real funny. You keep cracking jokes. They're going to sell Linux. Dell tried that. Right. Dell was doing
they're
that,
still
right?
They're still kind of trying.
Lenovo
like,
was doing
this kind of feels like Microsoft woke up and was like, oh, they're all screwed. Yeah. We can do whatever we want.
Yeah.
And they're just kind of doing whatever they want. I mean, they're going to make a phone eventually. I guarantee it. Right?
Yeah. So do you, Mary Jo, do you think Windows 8 will be a success? And do you think that what is success for Windows 8, and then what is success for the Surface?
Yeah, all
small
interesting
questions. Yeah, just small. You know, whatever.
Right. I think Windows 8 is going to be successful on tablets and not just on Surfaces. I think on a touch tablet, it's a really interesting and good user interface. I think on PCs, especially for business customers, maybe.
I mean,
not as sold on that one.
So, but business customers are really important to Microsoft.
They are.
I mean, they're really important
to
Microsoft.
Yes, they are.
I mean, if you were to, I mean, just, and you tell me, because you're the expert. I'm just nothing. I don't know anything. But if Microsoft were to lose, I'm just saying, like, suddenly it lost its enterprise customers, would it be in business?
No.
Okay, so they kind of have to make those people happy.
They do. Although, you know, if you look at what they did with Windows Phone, okay, not a gigantic seller, but... I'm one of the 3%
like
who
very
has
positive
one.
Spin on
Mary Jo has.
I do.
We talked backstage. She has a Windows phone.
Which one do you have?
I have the HTC Trophy, which is the only one right now in Verizon.
Yeah, because Verizon was like, why?
Yeah.
Wait, was there one clap? I heard one.
Come on,
I heard literally a single set of hands come together one time. It was like.
No, come on. We have our own shirts. We are the 3%.
You do.
We're like the Occupy.
We are the 3%.
That's us.
But you know, like, I don't, where, what, how should I feel about the 3%? Because the 1%, they're bad, right? They're bad, they're evil. They
the
gotta be stopped.
They're just downtrodden.
But the 3% are still super rich, right? I just want to be clear.
No.
They're like, but the. Masters of the universe.
We think different.
With Windows.
They can afford a Windows phone and then the iPhone that they actually use.
Yeah.
But no, we think different. I don't have an iPhone.
Wait, what? You think different?
Have you heard that somewhere before?
We got some mixed, some real mixed messages going on here.
I'm still curious about the first answer of Surface saving Windows 8. Just from a consumer perspective, that was all they were lacking? I feel like they have a ton to prove consumer-wise, not just in hardware. They have a ton software to prove.
I think with a tablet, your hardware experience is so tied to the software experience. You know, like when people see an iPad, what draws them to it? It's not the software. Like people don't go, wow, I want that operating system. You know, they want
They don't say those words.
But do they even think that?
Well, okay, but hardware will only get you so far.
Right, right.
Hardware is like, when you turn it on, if it's a terrible experience,
right.
You're like, God. You know, it doesn't matter how sexy the hardware. I mean, let me put it this way. I think the N900? I always get the Lumia. Is it N900?
No,
Lumia 900.
The Lumia 900. Sorry, I'm thinking of the N9.
Yeah.
Can they just figure out a better naming scheme? There's the N9, the 800, and the 900. It's confusing. But I think the 900 is the most beautiful looking piece of hardware in phones on the market. Mm-hmm. But because of the software and because of some hardware limitations just in terms of what they put in it, I mean, I wouldn't buy it. And I think a lot of people feel that way. You know, and so it will only get you so far.
But it helps.
It helps a lot.
It does.
But what would be great is if you pick it up and it's also like an amazing software experience, which is where they haven't gotten.
Right.
I mean, the HP touchpad was a nice piece of hardware.
Mm-hmm. Well,
it was all right.
Some very sad. All right, so let me shift gears a little bit here. Well, not completely, but so Microsoft posted its earnings recently, $492 million loss, but they had this Aquantiv write-down of $6.2 billion, which is no laughing matter. They paid, how much did they pay for Skype? $8.5 billion, which is insane, by the way. That number makes no sense to me. But how are they as a company? Like, where do you rank their health right now? Yep. No, but I mean,
they had a loss,
but in other areas, their performance is actually quite good.
Yes.
So they've had big growth in the entertainment devices division. So I'm just curious to know, like, what does that mean? Does it all even out, or?
Yeah, you know, when I looked at their numbers this time, because I look at them every quarter when they come out, obviously, what struck me is what's still powering Microsoft is their enterprise software. So products that some people in this audience might know, SharePoint, woo. Come on.
Are you rocking
there's
SharePoint?
There's someone else, isn't there?
SharePoint, go on.
Office, System Center, all these enterprise products, right? This is what is powering Microsoft. And so as long as these products continue to be healthy, they can keep taking losses on things that they're kind of throwing at the wall and seeing what's
going to stick. So are they just going to sell Windows 7 for a decade like they did with XP?
Maybe.
And like
Maybe.
See? That's super sad.
I mean, I guess the question is like, is that, as other people move into their spaces, though, you've got Google coming on strong. Apple's not, you know, believe me, I'm sure if they can get their hands on an enterprise customer, they're working hard to do that. You know, as their products become less and less, they become less and less desirable, certainly to consumers, doesn't that have a kind of echo effect? And by the way, I need to preface, I know everybody thinks I'm like the worst guy in the world because I gave the Lumia 900 a 7 out of 10. But I am excited about 8, and I'm excited about the Surface. I mean, from what I saw, I really like it. And so I have like this hope that this is going to be the thing that kind of changes their placement in the market, you know, in the minds of consumers. But if they keep losing consumers, if it isn't, you know, and if they have on this little bit of a downward movement in the consumer side, doesn't that eventually pull away from the enterprise with all these other forces competing?
Yeah, I'd say, you know, that's the thing they're trying to hedge against in what they're doing, right? So they're kind of still very rooted in the enterprise, but the ultimate plan, I think, is to start turning things around, starting with Windows 8. It's going to be a long process, I think they know. It's not going to be an instant overnight success, I don't think. I think even in the most optimistic Microsoft projections, nobody is going to say Windows 8 is going to just come out of the gate, boom, and knock Windows 7 off. No,
right.
It's not.
What's going on with the desktop? I mean, I think that's the thing, right? Because
right.
Windows 7 has, people know it. It's mm-hmm. It looks like every other version of
right.
Windows.
Right, and what if this version doesn't stick? That's too weird. And do they just try something else?
You know, what I'm guessing is going to happen, and this is just a pure guess. No one from Microsoft
really?
Has told me this. Pure, 100%
guess.
Do
we have people at the ready to hit this statement if it sounds really juicy? Go
Maybe.
On. Go on.
I think you're going to see, after Windows 8 comes out this October, I think you're going to start seeing Microsoft change how often they do Windows releases.
To go to yearly or whatever?
Right, to go closer to yearly, if not yearly. Right now, it's every 3 years. That's too long.
It's a lot of pressure every three
it
years.
Is.
You get, it's like you got to come with a
it
big...
Is.
It's almost like when you look at what Apple's doing, mm-hmm. they've, you know, the change from Lion to Mountain Lion is really iterative stuff.
It's like a service pack.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And if they called service packs up, you know, like actual, they gave them names or something, besides service pack, whatever, it might change
the
picture.
What does Windows 9 look like?
Yeah, can you tell us?
If I knew, I would...
I actually,
writing a blog post right now.
I asked a Microsoft rep who shall remain nameless, but he knows who he is. I said, you know, we were at the Surface event. I said, so if this is the transition, then Windows 9 won't have any Windows desktop in it, will it? You know? He was like, you don't really expect me to answer that question, do you? So,
and then, you know, and then he winked at you and he threw a mouse in the garbage.
That's a really, first I was like, why a mouse? Like a live mouse? Like, but.
There's a lot of deep symbolism.
What you just described would make a tremendous comic, and I would like to see somebody pen that. Okay, couple things. I wish we had more time. We went, if only I hadn't done that stupid intro. Couple quotes. And then I have a big question for you. Ballmer said that the coming months, it's the most exciting launch season in Microsoft history. Do you agree or disagree?
Agree, 100%.
This is like the highest pitch
it is.
Launch.
Like every single product at the company is about to be revved. in the next 12 months.
And then on the flip side, well, I mean, he's obviously excited, but Valve's Gabe Newell said this recently, like a day ago. I think Windows 8 is a catastrophe for everyone in the PC space. I think we'll lose some of the top-tier PC OEMs who will exit the market. I think margins will be destroyed for a bunch of people. If that's true, then it will be good to have alternatives to hedge against that eventuality.
I'm smirking because you know what his alternative was. Linux.
Well, that is insane.
Can you say, can you throw some more burns at Linux?
I can
do like a half hour of Linux burns with Mary Jo.
We know he doesn't like Apple because they're too controlling.
Right. And now he's mad that Microsoft's going to be more controlling.
Right. He just hates control.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is
why he runs.
But you don't.
Steam.
You don't agree. Exactly. You don't agree at this point, having seen the Surface. You don't think Windows 8 is a. You wouldn't describe it as a catastrophe, though. You did say prior to the Surface, you thought it was a disaster. I don't want to pour words in your mouth. Did you say disaster? I think you did.
Maybe I did. Yeah. I don't know.
we'll edit it out.
Catastrophe,
we'll
disaster.
Disastrophe.
Disaster.
It's waiting for you.
It's like
that'll be the tagline. Windows 8, disaster.
I think. Like I said, I think Windows 8 is going to be very interesting on touch tablets and possibly on touch laptops. I think people who install it on existing non-touch laptops are going to be surprised, if they haven't tried it already, about what that experience is like.
Surprised.
In a negative way.
makes me feel very sad. Those are the people who are going to be installing it, though, right? I mean, it's not everybody's going to be a new PC purchaser.
Well, you know, the way most people get Windows anymore is getting it on a new PC.
Right.
Most people aren't, like, you know, techies. They don't go put
a new operating system on. They're kind of like, we're going to take our chances.
Right.
But if you get it on a traditional laptop, the experience is your start menu is suddenly...
No more start button.
Right. There's no start button.
Right.
It's a completely different experience.
It is.
Like, people will be shocked and confused. Like, people who only know that, you know, who are using, like,
it's gonna be
Vista
a learning
or XP
curve.
Right now or something.
There's going to be a learning curve.
What was the learning curve for you? Like, it was really weird for me.
Yeah, it's really weird. Yeah. I'll tell you, I don't use Windows 8 on my laptop that I use for work. I don't.
Well, that's not a ringing endorsement.
You use Linux.
All right,
I use Linux. I shouldn't have told you that. Yeah,
she loves. She loves Linux. All right, final question. And I wish we had more time. I do. We got to have you come back. Maybe as we get closer to the launch around October or something, we could do like get rid of these guys.
Yeah.
Get Tom Warren
and
here.
Get a real table.
Get Paul Throt here.
That's
do
around.
A real Microsoft round. I won't be here either. is Ballmer destroying the company?
Oh, a light question to end.
Yeah, just a little light. I mean, because there was this Vanity Fair article. There was like, Ballmer's right. just spent the last 10 years right. dismantling Microsoft.
Yeah, but then
that Vanity Fair article
is
unfair.
The counterpoint to that is this whole write down of Aquantive and all
there
this.
There is.
Is the end of the Gates era.
Yes.
And now we're truly in the Ballmer era.
I agree with
which
you.
Which is kind of like revisionist history.
No, not really.
It's been the Ballmer era for a while.
Yes.
Like, has he just been like. And Steve Ballmer is not the sort of man who lies in wait.
No,
right? Like, he's there.
Oh, you don't know. But boy, would it be scary if he was lying. Right?
You
like, get in your car, and Ballmer's in the backseat. He's like, just drive. Just drive and don't say anything. Turn the radio to the sports station.
Or else,
yeah.
No, I don't think he's just been laying around waiting, but I think he also was cleaning up some messes that were left to him when he took over as a CEO.
And what were the messes that Bill Gates left to Steve Ballmer?
A number of projects
Tablets.
That weren't making money.
Tablet initiative.
That they've kind of gotten rid of, downplayed some things, closed divisions, gotten rid of things like Aquantive.
Yeah.
You know, like...
Aquantive was not a great...
It wasn't a great...
Anyhow, we have to wrap up. Mary Jo, thank you so much. You got to come
you.
Back.
I will.
Mary Jo Foley, everyone. And we got to stick around. Stick around. Don't go anywhere. We have a quick
just
break.
Drive.
Just drive. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back with Chipocrite. So stick around.
Why should other laptops bow down to the new Samsung Series 9 with the Intel Core i5 processor? Maybe it's because CNET claims the new Series 9 is one of the most impressively made laptops we've ever seen. The New York Times says, just touching it is good for the soul. How does that make us feel? Well, we're walking on air.
I'm told that our musical guest name has some kind of dual meaning. but I don't understand either one of them. Maybe you could figure it out while he's playing. Ladies and gentlemen, Chipocrite. So that's it. I want to thank Senator Al Franken, Mary Jo Foley, Paul and Nilay, of course, Chipocrite, and Samsung, our sponsor, for helping us put this on. And you guys, thank you so much for coming. Stick around. We've got some giveaways. And we're going to hear one more song. Thanks again.